Let's open our Bibles this afternoon to the book of Joel, chapter 3. It's a very prophetic book, very profound, an amazing book. Of course, every book of the Bible is profound. It's amazing. Holy men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. These were men and women that were moved by the Holy Ghost. They didn't write it from their intellect. They didn't write it from their feelings. They didn't write it from their emotions. They wrote it by the Spirit of the living God. And it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be, what? Perfect. Thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So really the perfection or the maturity that God brings us into is dependent upon the amount of the Word of God that we've hid in our heart. I've hid your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. And it's not just a memorization of the word, it was a meditation of the word. As I was musing, the fire burned, then spake I with my mouth. And when I first got born again, I didn't know anything. I didn't know any believers. All I had was my little military green Bible. And I opened it up, and the first thing that God gave me was a love for the truth. I loved the truth. I couldn't get enough of the truth. And I began to devour Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and I began to see, and I began to have a revelation of the perfect will of the Father. In Hebrews, it tells us that God, who spoke to the fathers in times past by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he the appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. And I fell in love with the truth, and the truth began to transform and change. Now, I was a brand new creation when I first got born again, but I needed the washing of the water of the Word. And he said he washes us with the water of the Word that we might be without spot or blemish or any such thing. A lot of people are trying to live holy lives. They're trying to live victorious lives. They're trying to overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil, ones who have committed their hearts to Christ. But the problem is they're trying to do it outside of God's Word in their heart. The level of success I have is going to be dependent upon the truth that is in my heart that I am submitted and surrendered to. Now, he told Joshua that because, remember, they're going to go in and they're supposed to overcome an enemy of giants, Hittites, Jebusites, Canaanites, Amalekites. I don't think there was any Yeagerites there. But they're supposed to overcome the enemy. And how are they going to do this? Well, of course, we understand they're going to do it by faith. They're going to be doing it by trust alone in God. It says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thy own understanding. Acknowledge him in all thy ways, and he shall direct thy paths. And so there was a group of men that had faith in God, and they went in, and God enabled them, equipped them, empowered them to overcome insurmountable odds. They marched around the walls of Jericho for 7 days, and on the seventh day, they kept their mouth shut until the seventh day, the seventh time, and then they shouted, and God caused the walls to fall flat. It was the Spirit of God, it was the power of God, it was the Word of God that brought this to pass. But he told Joshua something in Joshua 1:8. He said, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Only be strong and very courageous. Be not afraid, don't be dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. You see, the key was the Word of God hidden in our heart, meditated upon, and when the time came when God was going to move, he was there in the midst of them, because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. God and his Word are one. Now, I don't worship this book, but I tell you right now, this is God speaking to me. See, God speaks to me every day of my life audibly. It says, oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation day and night. And I can tell you the only reason I know that I've been able to stand for over 40 years, and many of the ministers I began with, many of the believers I've known have gone back into the world, they've gone back into the cares of life, the deceitfulness of riches, the lust of other things, because they did not hide the word of God in their heart. The Bible says, if any man thinks he stand, let him take heed lest he fall. I've got to keep the word of God in my heart. If you stop eating and drinking, you will dry up, you will wither up, and you will blow away. I need to abide in his word, and his word will abide in me, and I shall ask what I will according to the will of the Father, and it will be done. Now, we need to understand the aspect, what we're looking at tonight or today, is the subject of faith. Now, people don't realize this. Jesus taught more on the subject of faith than anything else. Not the hyper-faith, not the faith of me-ism and the faith I can get what I want. No, but Jesus, in the Gospel of Luke, when he was 12 years old, when Joseph and Mary found him, and they said, why did you trouble us? And he said, know you not, I must be about my Father's business. 12 years old. 12 years old, and he had a revelation. I've got a purpose. I've got a mission. I've got a job. I've got to set the captives free. You know, it says, he that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose, for this purpose, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now, when I talk about the works of the devil, I am not just talking about S-I-N, sin, disobedience, rebellion to God. I'm talking about every work of the devil. I'm talking about sickness and disease. I'm talking about depression and fear and anxiety. I'm talking about everything and anything that keeps us captive, that destroys our lives. Now, I'm so glad that when I first got born again, I did not get around traditional believers. All I got around was Jesus Christ. And I saw that Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, because I had physical afflictions. Lung problems, speech impediment, hearing problems, born with immovable bones. I used to end up in oxygen tents, and my mind had to keep all the dust out of the house. But I literally had a revelation. I saw by the Spirit of God, as I read Isaiah 53, 4, 5, Matthew 8, 17, 1 Peter 20, 24, I saw that by the stripes of Jesus, I was healed. I saw it. I had a revelation of it. By his stripes, I'm healed. And I took a hold of it. Not out of arrogance, not the fact that I deserved it, not the fact, but I discovered something, that my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. That he dwells in me and lives in me. Now, I'm like this glass, little object lesson, I'm like this glass. But before I got born again, the Bible says we're a temple, we're a house, we're a tabernacle that God created to dwell in. God made me to dwell in me, walk in me, and he made me to be one with him. To love what he loves and hate what he hates, to do what he does. And of course, I don't do it, Christ does it in me, the hope of glory. But before I got born again, my cup was filled with filth. It was filled with sewage. It says the very heavens are filthy before God. How much more man that drinketh iniquity like it's water? I got a revelation of my lost condition. I got a revelation of how I broke the heart of God in my rebellion. I got a revelation of how sick and twisted and perverted I was. And I hated that part of my life, and I cried out to Christ. But when I got born again, repentance, or when you truly believe and receive Christ. Now, I don't believe in this mess of ask Jesus into your heart. I believe in give your heart to God. Give your heart to God. Psalms 23 or Proverbs 23. Give me thy heart, O man. That's the gospel we need to be preaching. A total, complete, radical abandonment of your will, because his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so I gave my heart to Christ, and at that moment, I tipped my cup upside down, and all the filth was dumped out. Now, I'm not saying I was perfect when the baby's first born. They're not perfected. They mature. They learn to crawl. They learn to walk. They learn to run. Eventually, aren't you glad they learn to stop filling their diapers? How many glad? How many had kids and you're so glad? How many glad you don't fill your diapers no more? None of you, huh? I'm so glad I don't fill my diapers no more, you know. Now, maybe sometimes in a natural I do, you know. Maybe sometimes as a human being I throw a fit and I act stupid, act dumb. I know you don't, but sometimes I do. And I got to ask God to forgive me and get cleaned all up again. But all that filth was dumped out. And then when I got born again, I had to take the water of the word and I had to begin to wash my cup. I had to begin to be sanctified by the truth. See, you know what? If this cup was full of filth and you dumped it out, you're not going to be able to clean it with your bare hands. Even if you had a cloth, you could stick it in there and they'll say it was full of manure, full of poop. You ain't going to get it all out. You're going to have to stick it in the water. You're going to have to wash it. That's what the Word of God does. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And I began to meditate upon the word. I've never stopped. Oh, how I love thy laws, my meditation all the day. I did find thy word and I did eat them, and it was a joy and rejoicing of my heart. And I began to just devour the word. Now, nobody told me to do this. It must have been God. And everything else I cut out. Everything. Didn't read anything else. Now, years later, I began to read some wonderful books, and I'm sure we've read a lot of the same books from Ravenhill and Tozer and Smith Wigglesworth and John G. Lake and Alexander Dowie and Mary Woodworth Edder and John Wesley, and didn't read much of George Whitfield, because I tell people, to say, are you a Calvinist or an Arminianist? I said, I'm neither one of them. They're both wrong. I'm a Jesusist. I'm a Jesus man from head to toe. In him I live and move and have my being. He's my all in all. He's the vine and I'm a branch. And I want his life to flow through me. So I totally believe we're supposed to be the embodiment of Christ in the earth, that when people run into us, they're running into Jesus. They ought to feel Jesus in me. They ought to see Jesus in me. They ought to experience Jesus in me. I should be so full of Christ, and I want to talk about that, because really what we're looking at in the book of Joel chapter 3, and this is actually what Peter was preaching on the day of Pentecost. Notice what he said in the book of Joel chapter 3. On the day of Pentecost he began to preach this, but actually in chapter 3, and I'm going to begin here with verse 12. This is a prophetic word. I believe we are living in this moment. So get excited. Listen to what it says here. Let the heathen be wakened. Wow. Let the heathen be wakened. You know, he gave a promise to the son. He said, ask of me for the heathen, and I will give them to thee for thy inheritance. Praise the Lord, I was one of them. I ain't no more. Ask of me for the heathen, and I will give them to you. And Jesus did, and we were one of them. Let the heathen be awakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about. Listen to this. Put ye in the sickle. Wow. Not out there with just a little paring knife, but now you got a sickle. For the harvest is ripe. Come get you down, for the press is full. The fats overflow. Listen to this. For their wickedness is great. I'm telling you prophetically that I believe the scripture declares that when their wickedness is great, it is harvest time. It's harvest time, people. It says, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth and is patient until he receives the early and latter rain. He is. That's why we're still here. That's why the trumpet hasn't sounded yet. That's why we haven't been taken out of this earth yet, because there is about to be the greatest harvest of souls you have ever seen. The latter would be greater than the former. I'm telling you, we are getting ready to see a mighty outpouring of the Spirit. Now, I don't exalt my experiences and my visitations and the supernatural things that God does in my life. It doesn't take place of the Word, because the Word of God is first. Then I've got to bring my experiences. If they're not aligned with the Word, I get rid of it. But one day, I was only saved for about 2 months. God had already dropped me into hell, and all I wanted was Jesus. All I needed was Jesus. All I did was sing and talk and preach Jesus. Everywhere I went, I wasn't trying to preach Jesus. I was just full of Jesus. I wasn't trying to preach the Word. I was just full of the Word. I wasn't trying to be a light. I was just full of the light. And one day I'm in my barracks, and nobody ever taught me to travail in birth. But Paul said, I travail in birth again until Christ might be outwardly expressed in you. And so I found myself praying 24 hours a day. And sometimes when I wasn't at work, I'd be in my barracks and I would be walking the floor and I would be weeping and crying for souls. Oh God, give me souls, because I saw that one soul was worth more than all the wealth of this world. And I'd be crying for souls. Oh God, give me the desires of my heart. And all I want is souls. I don't want fame. I don't want wealth. I don't want position. I don't want power. I want souls. God, give me souls. And I'd be crying for souls. And as I was praying, the presence of God came flooding into my room. And I fell on my knees, and the hair on the back of my neck stood up. And whether you believe this or not, a white portal opened up. And this being, who was probably over 7 feet tall, came stepping out of that white portal. And I felt like a dead man, and I began to shake like a bowl of jelly on an out-of-balance wash machine. Fear of God hit me, and this angel walked up to me, and he told me to stand upon my feet, son of man. And he took me by the hand, and he took me through that white portal, and he took me into the future. And I saw the nations of the world come to God. I saw men and women of every nation, every nationality, every color, every background you can imagine. I saw them come into the kingdom of God just like that, suddenly. So all of these years, I've been waiting, I've been anticipating, I've been expecting, but it hasn't happened yet, but it's about to happen. Now, I was in prayer last night, and I wasn't in prayer because I was so spiritual I couldn't go to sleep. I had one of them... How many drink some of that coffee we got in yesterday with the milk? I couldn't go to sleep. My wife couldn't go to sleep. So I'm laying there and I'm praying and I'm talking to the Lord and I'm quoting the Word. And at 4:44 in the morning, I finally fell asleep. That's why I wasn't over here this morning at 6. But in that time, the Lord was speaking to me. And a lot of times I do more listening than I do talking, if you can believe that. And I heard the Lord told me to tell Jed that by this coming fall, the nets you cast into the ocean will be full like never before. There's about to be a shift. There's about to be a change. See, remember, Peter and them worked all night long, and they didn't hardly have any fish, but all of a sudden, the Lord said, throw the net over on the other side, when it seemed like it was the worst time to go fishing. See, I was a fisherman in Oregon. I was a fisherman in Alaska. I worked on a halibut boat. I worked on the salmon boat. If you ever seen the show, I never seen it. The most dangerous job in the world, I was out there. I was out there in the Bering Sea in Alaska in the midst of those storms. And I remember one day we're out there fishing for fish, and we had our gill nets out, and we were getting a couple of fish, and all of a sudden the captain started yelling, hurry up, Mike, hurry up. It was only 2 men per boat. It was about a 30-some foot vessel, and we had hydraulic jumps. And I said, what's wrong, captain? He said, look it. And our great big bulbers that held the top of the net up began to sink, and I saw nothing but white splashing. Fish everywhere, salmon everywhere, pink salmon, they were just everywhere. And he turned on the hydraulic machine, and we're pulling it in, and I'm pulling it in, and it was and the net was so heavy that with the gill net I was ripping my hands open. And we didn't have time to take the fish out of the net, throw it into the big fish box in the belly of the ship of the boat. We had to pull it in, and next thing you know, we had this humongous mountain of fish overflowing the sides, and my hands smelt like fish. My body was filled with slime, and oh, what an amazing catch. In just about an hour, where we had been out there many days and not seen near that much. Wow, that's the most amount of money I ever made. And one day I got 10% of the catch. And as a young man of 19 years old, I made almost $1,000 in an hour. But they came suddenly, never expecting it. And he tells us here, look what it goes on to say here. Oh, this is such an amazing verse, and it's a promise from God. In verse 14, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. Oh, my. Multitudes. Not one or two or three or 100 or 1,000, but multitudes and multitudes in a valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. And he says in verse 15, and the sun and the moon shall be darkened and the stars shall withdraw their shining. Did you know that's exactly what Peter preached in Acts chapter 2? That's a part of the scripture that he quoted. And people say, well, praise the Lord, the Holy Ghost came. No, that was just the beginning. There is a grand finale. I was telling Brother Bro Cole that my family and I were at a little apple harvest over here in the Artsville area here last year, and we were there the night they're going to have their fireworks, and it's just a little place. It's not very big. It's not like a big city, and all of a sudden, they're beginning to throw the fireworks off. One goes, two goes, three goes, four goes, and although this is fine, and of course, you know, we're all expecting grand finale, and, you know, grand finale, they're probably going to have 10 or 15 fireworks at the same time, and all of a sudden, the grand finale began, and there goes one of the rockets, and another, and we're standing there, and I'm telling you, I've been, and I've seen fireworks, but I never saw so many fireworks in my life, and this thing went on, and for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and I mean, the whole heavens are filled, and my wife and my kids are standing there, and our mouth is hanging open, and we're going, whoa, who'd ever thought there would be such a grand finale? I'm telling you, we are about to have a divine Holy Ghost grand finale. We're about to have a grand. I saw it. The angel of the Lord took me to heaven. I saw the coming harvest. Back in 2008, I was standing. I got up early in the morning to pray, to meditate, to seek God. And as I'm standing there, I'm looking off to the east, not even thinking. And the ceiling of my room disappeared. I'm not lying, I'm not exaggerating, disappeared. And all of a sudden I look up there and I saw seven angels in white garments, must have been 30, 40 feet tall, and they all had golden trumpets to their lips. And I looked off to their right, and there was Christ on a white horse, and on his side was written the Word. And I saw the armies of heaven behind him, and I'm watching, my eyes are just as big as saucer plates, you know, and I'm whoa, because I'm overwhelmed with what I'm seeing. And then all of a sudden, I know they're waiting. The angels are waiting for Christ to give the word, to blow the trumpets. And all of a sudden, I saw this tsunami come up over the top of Christ. And I knew in my heart, he was waiting for the last outpouring of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, that tsunami is about to hit. I had a friend of mine, good friend of mine, Henry Gruber. How many of you ever heard of Henry? You ought to look him up, an amazing man of God. Been walking the nations for many, many, many years. And he was in Japan. Now, I had this experience before the tsunami hit Japan, but he's in Japan and he's at that airport. You can see it on the videos. He's at that airport, he told me. He came right here after that, and he told me, he said, Mike, he said, the Lord said, get out, get out. Remember the time that Elijah told his servant, go up and look and see if there be any clouds, and there was nothing. Seven times, and he finally came down. He said, there's a hand the size of a man. He said, you better tell the king he better get in this chariot because the rain is coming. I'm telling you, the rain is coming. And all of a sudden, there was this gusher, and Henry told me, he said, the Lord told me, get out of here now. And he got on the plane, and right after he took off in the plane to get out of that airport, nobody knew it was coming, here came the tsunami. Whew. Now, before the tsunami hit, though, a lot of people, they were there down by the shore enjoying the water and the waves and the sand. And right before the tsunami hit, the water withdrew, went way out. People thought, wow, this is marvelous, not even thinking something was wrong. And they went out, and here it is. They're picking up seashells, and they're looking. And all of a sudden, they looked, and they saw a wall of water. Over 300 feet tall. and they could not escape. And the Lord said to me, son, before the tsunami of my spirit hits the earth, there will be such a dryness and a deadness, and it will look like the moving of the spirit is withdrawing. And then my spirit will come like a mighty wave, and it will sweep multitudes into the kingdom. Now, multitudes in the valley of decision. And here we are in the valley of death called Gettysburg. This day, July the 3rd, 1863, 152 years ago, there was 45,000 men dead in the fields and the highways and the byways. 45,000 men. Approximately 28,000 of them were the Union soldiers, and the other ones were, the rebels. And 45,000 men who had given their blood for that which they believed. And some of them died to free those who were considered slaves, and other ones fought for what they considered to be their freedoms, the state rights. But they all died. Well, I heard a man say one time he became a martyr. A man is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Now, some people say that's Calvinism. Well, I'm not talking about Calvinism. I'm saying we are no fools if we give what we cannot keep anyways to gain what we cannot lose. We'll not lose our rewards if we continue to the end. That was a valley of decision. I'm telling you right now, the world is in the midst of a valley of decision. But I'm telling you that God is about to do something amazing. Now, what was the answer to this situation where they're in the valley of decision, where multitudes, wickedness is overflowing? What is God's answer to this? And if you take a look here in chapter 2 and verse 28, well, look there in verse 31. The sun shall be turned to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. What does it mean, the great and terrible day of the Lord? I'll tell you what my eschatology is. Of course, it's not pre, post, or mid. It's pan. It's all going to pan out. But my eschatology is this. Before the great and notable day of the Lord, there will be a mighty outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And the thing is, see, before fishing season began, we had to get that boat ready. We had to get it prepped. We had every night after we fished, even though it would be late, we'd have to stretch out our gill net and put it up on racks, and we would have to sew the net back together where fish would tear it loose in order to get ready for the next day. So when the day that I was out there on that fishing vessel, when all of a sudden this school of fish hit our net, we were ready. Today is preparation time. We got to get ready. Get ready for a great harvest. Get ready for a great outpouring. Get ready for multitudes and multitudes coming into the kingdom. Get ready for this. Well, I don't believe it, Pastor Mike. Well, you better get to believe in it. You better begin to develop your faith. You better begin to trust the Lord that He's going to do what He says He's going to do. See, the Bible says you got to be like a child to enter the kingdom of heaven. In the natural, I'm very childlike. I just believe. And if you ever read any of our books, you would discover how I believe. Here's one example. It really happened. I got a radio tower over there, and the bulb burned out. Well, I don't want to pay somebody $250 to climb that tower. And so I went over there, but I lost the key to open the gate. And so I had my climbing gear on, and so I had two guys with me. So I began to climb the fence, rickety fence, you know, barbed wire on the top, and I finally got up there. And when I got up there, my climbing gear got stuck in the fence, and I fell over. And when I fell over, I landed on my right foot sidewards. When I landed on my foot sidewards, I felt it snap. Now, I'm just kind of a foolish guy. The Bible says the kingdom of heaven self violence and violence take up our force. I never tell anybody to do something except if it's a gift of faith in me. But I said to the Lord, Father, forgive me. I'm so sorry, Lord, for being so stupid. I need you so much, Jesus. And so I said, well, I command that foot to be healed in the name of Jesus. Foot be healed. Well, I really didn't believe it was healed, but I said, I'm going to climb the tower anyways. Now, I don't really like climbing 250 feet as it is. I hyperventilate, but I'm going to save $250. So I began to climb that tower with a broken foot, and I'd get 30 feet, and I'd stop. It's only, you can see it over there. The tower's only about this wide. And so the guys left me alone because they know that pastor's pastor. You know, they learned years ago. So I get up there. Finally, I get to the top, and I get the bulb changed, and I'm coming back down. Now my foot is big, black, and blue, and swollen. I go into the front office, and I tell everybody why. I believe I'm healed, but my foot is broken. Yeah. So I make my way to our house across the parking lot. My wife was in the bedroom putting away the clothes, and I told her, honey, I broke my foot, but I believe I'm healed. Now listen to this. How stupid can we be, you know? So I get my shoe off, and I get my sock off, and I put my foot up on the pillow, and my foot's big, black, and blue, and swollen. I'm laying there. I'm full of pain, and I'm just laying there at 3 in the afternoon, and I heard the audible voice of God. Now you say, Mike, Pastor Mike, that's disputable. Well, let me tell you what happened. I heard the audible voice of God, and he said this to me. What are you doing in bed? That's what he said to me. Whoa, my wife didn't hear it. I heard him. I said, Lord, I'm resting in my heart. He said, in my heart. He said, do you always rest at this time in the afternoon? I said, no, Lord. He said, I thought you said you were healed. And when he said that, the gift of faith exploded in my heart. Now, don't do this without the gift of faith. Gift of faith exploded in my heart. I jumped up off of the bed. I said, bless God, I'm healed. Now, my foot's exactly the same, so I take my sock, and I got to work it over that big, black, blue, swollen foot. And I work it over and over. It hurts. And I took my foot and got it into my tennis shoe, and I had to squirm it and work it in. If you can imagine, a big old sausage of a foot in a pair of tennis shoes. And I finally got it tied up, and I went to stand up, and I about blacked out. Now, when I went about to black out, something supernatural happened, though. This divine, holy anger rose up in me. Anger. Not at God, but at the devil. Oh, I'm so mad at the devil. I'm so mad at him because Jesus took my pains and he bore my sicknesses. He's already paid the price for my healing. I knew this because the Bible says, you know of Jesus of Nazareth, how God anointed him with the Holy Ghost and power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. So I'm so mad at the devil. I could stamp my foot, and so I thought, that's what I'm going to do. So I lifted my foot as high as I could. I said, you lying devil, in the name of Jesus, I'm healed. And I slapped my foot down as hard as I could. And it was the 4th of July. Black, green, blue, yellow, orange. Oh, I blacked out. You can ask my wife. You can ask the congregation that was here. I blacked out. They weren't there, but my wife was. I fell down. I'm laying, she said, I'm out for 10 to 20 seconds. And then I came to, and I come to, and I'm madder now than ever. I'm as mad as a wet hand, whatever that means. I jump up, and I do it the second time in the name of Jesus, and I black out again. And every time I slam my foot down, it's getting worse. I get up the third time, and I slammed it down again as hard as I could, and I blacked out. Now, this time when I came to, my wife is standing over the top of me as white as a ghost, and she says, I can't watch you do this. You're making me sick. So she walks out of our bedroom. I jump back up and I do it again in the name of Jesus. And I black out again. And I jump up again and I do it again in the name of Jesus as hard as I could. And my foot was normal. No, it was normal. No, I mean, it was normal. See, this is the kind of Christianity my kids know. This is the kind of Christianity my children have experienced. They can tell you a story. I've literally got over 300 stories along that line of God divinely. What faith? He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, I can't make you walk in that realm, but I sure can put some salt in your water. I can sure tell you there's more than what you have, more than what you experience. There is a realm where all things are possible to him that believeth. But you've got to give yourself, like the disciples said in the book of Acts, where they said, we will give ourselves continually to the prayer and the ministry of the word. So what was God's answer to this multitudes of multitudes in the valley of decision? He tells us what it was. Take a look what it says in verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters will prophesy, and your old men shall see visions. In chapter 1, he tells us in verse 12, therefore also know, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, with fasting and with weeping and with mourning. There's repentance. See, he's the father of lights, in whom there's no vermin, neither shadow of turning. Every good gift comes from him. I remember one time I was preaching to this congregation, and it was right around Christmas time, and you know, people go on crusades against a Christmas, and my kids never were raised to believe in Santa Claus. They knew he was make-believe, he wasn't real, but I never went on a crusade against it except one time. I probably could have used some wisdom. It was a Christmas morning, and I had a man in our church all dressed up like Santa Claus, and I had him come up, and he had a bag full of hot air balloons, and he had a great big old sign that said Xmas, and he comes up, and I said, who knows what Christmas is about? And he came up, and I said, you know what Christmas is about? And he said, yeah, and he said on the mic, toys, this. I said, well, you know what? He had a mask on, you know, and I said, I think you're nothing but a big fat liar. I grabbed his sign, I ripped it up. I grabbed off his mask, and there was the devil. And then I grabbed, and he had long johns, and I grabbed his belt, and his pants fell down. I lost people out of that. They didn't think it was very nice for me to expose Santa Claus as nothing but a lie. But the devil's a liar. How many know the devil's a liar? And I'm not saying there wasn't a man like that, but that's not what Christ is about. But I had taken a package, and I had wrapped it in paper, and I had written on the signs all the gifts that God has given to us: healing, true prosperity, love, joy, peace, the gifts of the Spirit, the manifestation gifts, you know, the power gifts, revelation gifts, and the utterance gifts. And I'm going through this, right? And I said, how many agree with that gift? And they're, oh, yeah, yeah. And then I flipped it around, and on the side of that package was written the word, big and bold, repentance. I said, how many know that repentance is a gift? I said, it's an amazing gift. It's a wonderful gift that God can convert us because we agree with him. We accept what he says. He says it's wrong. We say it's wrong. And I said, but you know what most of you do? And I took that big old Christmas box and I kicked it across the room. I said, you kick away the gift of repentance and you damn your souls. We have a hard job to do, I know. But how do we do this? How? We do it by the power of the Holy Ghost. Right? We do it by the power of the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm going to ask someone who's kind of bold, one of the young guys who's not afraid of what I'm going to do to him. I want one of you young guys that's not afraid of what I'm going to do to you. Come and sit in this front chair. No, not you, Stephen. I don't want my family. Well, you can't point your finger at him, brother. You ought to be up here. Now, you're not afraid of what I'm going to do to you. Sit down there, and you can't be offended. You know, it says, great peace have them that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. My wife likes quoting that word to me all the time. So the power of the Holy Ghost, right? I mean, this is how God's going to gather the multitudes. That's what happened on the day of Pentecost. All of a sudden, Peter's preaching by the power of the Spirit, by the Holy Ghost, by the fire of heaven. And all of a sudden, there's 3,000 that comes under conviction, and they get gloriously born again. And then a couple of days later, silver and gold have I not, such as I have. And 5,000 get gloriously saved, right? Amazing. So when you first get born again, of course, the first thing that happens to you is that you begin to wash the inside of your cup, and this, you got a little bit of the Spirit. Really, I mean, you're born again and Christ is in you. You got a little bit of the Spirit. But you know what Christ said? Christ said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. So as a believer, the Spirit of God is in you. You get baptized in the Holy Ghost. Maybe you should speak in tongues. You have a little bit of the Holy Spirit. But guess what? You got to keep getting filled and filled and filled. Now, the Bible says that the Spirit of God is like the water coming underneath the threshold of the Holy of Holies, and it's ankle deep. You're in the water. No denying when you get born again, you get filled with the Holy Ghost. You're in the water, but how do you know? You can't swim. You're ankle deep. So you got to go deeper. You got to want more. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. They will be filled. You got to want more of Christ and less of you. You have got to want this. You've got to desire this. Now, that's how it was when I first got born again. I wanted all of Jesus I could get. And matter of fact, what did Paul say? For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be filled with the Spirit of his might, that you might be filled, that you might know the height, the depth, the width, the length, the love of Christ, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. All the fullness of God. All the fullness of God. So you get born again, you speak in tongues, you have some moving of the Spirit, you got the Spirit, but you're only this full. And you think you're full. You think you have it all. You think you got everything you need, but you ain't. You ain't there yet. You know, I was thinking about Paul the Apostle. Even in Philippians chapter 3, he said, that I might know him. Paul, don't you know him? Not enough. I don't know him enough. I tell you right now, I do not know Christ enough. How much of the Spirit you got, Pastor Mike? Not enough. Not enough. I don't have enough. Now, you say, well, why doesn't God fill me to overflowing? He's asking you, well, why won't you let me fill you to overflowing? He says to the church in Ephesians, awake thou that sleepest, arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. He's talking to the church. Awake thou that sleepest, arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. And be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. How many of you ever got drunk in the natural? Any of you? Vicky came in here one day. Didn't you, Vicky, raise your hand? And she came in as an alcoholic. She came in drunk. I didn't even know it. She walked into this church drunk on alcohol, an alcoholic lost and damned. And I was preaching under the power of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God was touching and healing and delivering. I gave an altar call, and I remember Vicky coming to the front. I didn't know if she was Pentecost or not. Laid my hands on her. The power of God hit her, and she fell to the floor, and she began to come here. Been coming here for years, and I only discovered a couple years ago, she said, Pastor Mike, when I came here and I was an alcoholic, but when I got up off the floor, I was free. I've never had another drink. That was the power of the Holy Ghost. That was the Spirit of the living God. God got on her and ripped the hunger and the desire for alcohol right out of her. See, preaching could not have done it without the Spirit. And to the level of the Spirit I'm in is to the degree of success I will have. And so you got the Spirit, and you say, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, I speak in tongues, but the evidence of your Spirit, of the Spirit, is what? It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. It's power, it's life, it's victory, it's authority, it's dominion. I'm telling you right now, a little bit of success I've had, I could have never had it without the Holy Ghost. See, I don't understand, and I can't relate with Christianity without the power of God. I just can't do it. I was ministering one day, and there was a little girl whose hands was covered completely with warts, completely covered. I told him, I said, God's going to remove those warts from your little girl. What? We've taken her to all the doctors we can. I said, God's going to remove those warts. See, Paul said, my preaching and teaching was not enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and the power, that your faith would not stand in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God. And so I laid my hands on her. I'm not a faith healer. Prayed for her. Nothing seemed to happen, but I'm not moved by that. I know God hears prayers. I know he answers prayers. I know, well, why doesn't God heal people when I pray for them? You don't pray for them. You got to pray for them. See, he says he confirms his word with signs following. I tell you, we were having signs and wonders and miracles, and one day all the miracles stopped, and very little miracles. And I was complaining to God one day. I said, Lord, how come there's no signs and wonders and miracles? He said, well, that, you're not following the biblical pattern I gave you. I said, what? He said, preach the word, and I will confirm the word with signs following. He said, you don't give me a chance to do miracles. He said, you preach and then it's over with. He said, start laying your hands on the sick. Just wait on me a little bit. I'll start confirming it. So I sent that couple home and they called me back later and they were a little bit offended. They said, Reverend, Pastor, whatever you are, and the wife, you know, she was a mess and the husband was an alcoholic and drug user and womanizer, and they're a mess. I mean, there ain't no way I could spend hours and hours counseling them. I could have never changed them. And I gave them the word, but then I prayed for the little girl. It was quickened in my heart. And so they called me and they said, nothing's happened. I said, don't worry. I started laughing. I said, it's done. I didn't tell them, now believe God. I said, no, the gift of faith was in me. I said, it's done. What do you mean the gift of faith? There is a gift of faith. There is a gift of healings. There is a gift of miracles. One time I was out ministering, and I tell you what, I get so deep in the Holy Ghost, sometimes it scares me, and I'm so deep in the Spirit. There's a woman that the Lord showed me. She had TMJ. I'm telling you, in front of everybody, I hauled off and slapped her as hard as I could. I slapped this woman. Everybody, whoo! And then I kept preaching and praying for other people, and then it hit me. You slapped that woman in the face. As hard as you could. She must have marks in her face from your fingers. And so I very timidly walked back around because it was on the right side of her face. I looked and there was not one mark on her face. She's crying. And I said to her, I said, dear miss, I said, when I slapped you, did it hurt you? She said, you did what? She didn't even know I slapped her. She's crying. I said, when I touched you, I said, what happened? She says, my jaw is healed. My jaw is healed. My jaw is healed. Vicky got up off the floor, no longer an alcoholic. I got up off my barracks floor, no longer a drug user, pornography, alcohol, tobacco, chewing tobacco, cussing, swearing. I got up by the Spirit of God. I said, by the Spirit of God. I said, by how? I'm going to pour out my spirit. And I'm going to begin to do signs and wonders and miracles. And this is what the will of God, he says, by my spirit. Not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. So they say, okay, Pastor Mike, how come we're not seeing God move like he wants to? Now, I could tell you story after story. I'm going to tell you honestly. It's easier for me to get a sinner healed than it is to get a saint. I see sinners healed all the time. I ran into a man one day trying to share Christ, and he told me, he said, because I could tell something was wrong with him. He said, I was in a terrible car accident. He said, I slammed my head against the concrete. He said, I've been deaf in my left ear ever since. And I said, well, listen, that's nothing for God. He can take care of that. I said, will you let me pray for you? He said, yeah. So I wet my finger, stuck it in his ear. I said, in the name of Jesus, you foul spirit of deafness, come out right now. And so pulled my finger away. He went, he started crying, shaking. I mean, the guy lost it. He was about my age. He began to hug me and hug me. He said, I can't believe it. He said, I haven't heard in my ear for three years. He said, they said, I'd never hear it. I'm hearing. He's crying. He's weeping. Snot's rolling. He's hugging me. And I'm kind of like, okay, brother. Okay, sir. He wasn't a brother yet. I said, do you want to accept Christ? Oh, I want to give him my heart. And I led him into prayer. I didn't tell him he was saved. When I can't save anybody. I've never won a soul to Christ. The Bible says he that wins souls, but I never got anybody saved. God saves them. God rescues them. See, I'm telling you, without the power of Christ in the ministry that I do, I would have been dead many times. I was over in the Philippines, and the Lord would always send me to what we would call the most dangerous parts. And when I went to the Philippines, a lot of people stay in Manila, but there's a province called Samar, and it's full of New People's Army. You'll read about them. It's communist. And the Lord said, go out there to the destitute, the lost, the dying. They don't have nothing. And so it takes a lot of work to get out there. And I got out there, and there was a Filipino college we were supporting. And so what we would do is we'd go into a town square, and they would say, hey, there's a white man coming to town. And we're in areas where they haven't seen white men since World War II. So the whole village would come out. The whole village would come out to see this white man who's so stupid, who the communists are going to kill. There was one time when the army begged me and a friend of mine who's up in Bangor, Maine, Ron Morris, don't come here, they'll kill you. Don't stand on the stage, the snipers will get you. And we said, yeah, but listen, God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. And so I stood up and I preached, and when I preach, you can lay hands on a sick, but I speak healing. I speak healing, and blind eyes start popping open, and deaf ears start opening, and people start getting delivered. And every place I went, we started a church, and they were willing to come. Now, do I preach repent? Do I preach holiness? Do I preach obedience? Yes. Do I believe in a living faith, not a dead faith. I believe if you be dead with him, you'll live with him. But I teach them, give your heart to God. I was down in Suriname, a little country below Brazil, and I'm preaching down there, and really this is a message the church needs to hear. And I'm preaching, and it came to my mouth, and my son Daniel was with me, 100%. And in English, I had him say 100%. And the whole congregation, the Spirit would come on them, and they're all shouting 100%. I said, give Jesus everything. Give him every moment, every second, every hour, every thought, every desire, every part of your life, and God will show up. And I was down there, and this Hindu girl, a devil was in her, a demon was in her. She wasn't even born again. And I began to speak the word, and she fell down. Phew, demons manifesting. Preachers got around her. Preacher got, come on, come on, come on, going on and on and on. And I said, shh, 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 stop. Submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Shh, shh, pushed him away. Got down, laid my hands, didn't lift my voice. I said, in the name of Jesus, you foul spirit, come out of her and loose her now. I stepped away from her about 3 feet. I'm standing there waiting, praying, and all of a sudden she's worse now than before, because that's what Jesus said. I learned this from Jesus, the ministry of Jesus. She's in contortions, she's worse, but the devil would tear them before they'd come out. And all of a sudden I saw physically the devil leave her. A sweetness came over her face. Tears are rolling down her cheeks, and I led her to Jesus. And the last time I went down there again, she was in every service. The power of God did it. Oh, the preaching, but the power. So this couple, they called me late at night. They said, Reverend Yeager, our little girl Ruthie, her hand is still completely covered with warts. I started laughing, nodding in mockery. My wife can confirm this. I said, it's okay. The devil's a liar. It's all right. Early the next morning, my phone is ringing. They call up. They said, Pastor Mike, Pastor Mike. I said, what? They said, she got up this morning and every wart is gone but one. And they brought her over and they showed us, and they both gave their hearts to Christ and became filled with the Holy Ghost and became workers in the kingdom. Can you give the Lord a hand clap and a shout? I've overcome my time, but here's the challenge. Brothers and sisters, now listen to me. When you get born again, now before we get born again, we're a sponge. We're all sponges. How many know that even your skin is a sponge? That's why they put nicotine patches on your skin. You're a sponge. If I would take this sponge and dip it into sewage, right? Whatever I slap with it would be full of sewage. I ain't got no whatever I slap with it. I'm a sponge. So let me tell you something. I've got to be very careful what I'm full of. If I'm full of bitterness, I'm going to slap bitterness all over you. Now, some people are spiritually mature enough to where they won't let it affect them, but most people aren't. That's why if you're full of bitterness, the person you're talking to will end up being full of bitterness. Not they won't be if you preach the truth. I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying, take heed lest the spirit of bitterness rise up in you, many be defiled in the house of God. Now, if I'm full of depression, and I slap you with depression, it's going to get on you if you're not. Have you got around somebody who was ever sad? Gets on them. Now listen, as a minister of the gospel, I'm supposed to be a minister of the spirit, not of the letter. How does that work, Pastor Mike? He therefore that doth miracles among you, does he do it by the works of law, by the hearing of faith? He does it by faith. See, it's all by faith in Christ. And so I believe what God says. Now, in a great house, there are vessels of gold and of silver and of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. But if a man will purge himself, say himself, of these things, he shall be a vessel unto honor, meet for the master's use, prepared in every good work. So maybe I get born again. I'm in the house of God. I'm a vessel of wood. I'm a vessel of clay. I'm a vessel of silver. But see, if I'm not the kind of man I need to be, I can be. How? It says, meditate upon the word that your profiting may appear to all. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So here I am as a born-again believer. I'm a sponge. I'm a sponge. And I'm supposed to be full of the Spirit, right? So let's just say, here's the Word of God and the Spirit of God. Now if it's not just the Word. It's not just the Word. Jesus said, my words are spirit and they are life. The flesh profit nothing, is the spirit that quickeneth, right? So let's say I'm born again, I'm called to preach, right? And now my job, listen to this, my job is to get you wet with the Spirit. I've got to get the Spirit of God on you. What do you mean? Prayer cloths taken by the hands of Paul came upon the demon possessed and they came out. The Spirit of God is an invisible substance. So I get born again, and my job is to get you wet with the Spirit. Because why? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. So I've got the Spirit. Now my job, this brother here, he's an alcoholic, he's a homosexual, which you're not, he's a wino, he's a drug user, he's an idolater, a fornicator, a heretic, right? So I come and I'm preaching, and out of the abundance of my heart the mouth speaketh, and out of my belly's flow rivers of living water, and I got a little bit of spit coming out. I won't spit on you. I'm a sponge. I go, be free. I said, be free. A little bit of water hits him. He feels it. He experiences it. A little bit of touch. A little dab will do you. I go, wow, I saw conviction hit him. I know God touched him. That's what a lot of preachers do. I go, God, what's wrong? What's wrong? I read about Charles Finney and John Wesley, and I read about Alexander Dowie, and I read about Mary Woodworth Edder, and I read about Brother Seymour, and I read about the Great Awakening in 1730 and the Second Great Awakening in early 1800s, and I read about the Azusa Street Revival, and I'm preaching and I'm teaching and I'm proclaiming and but Lord, they're not melting. They're not transformed. Well, it's just the hardness of the heart. And I don't look at that. I say, Lord, I've got a problem. It's me. It's Lord, what is it? He said, you're not full of the Spirit. But be not drunk with wine where is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. How? Speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs, sing and make it well in your heart. Giving thanks to the Lord, right? Submitting yourself one to another in fear of God. Then it says something wives don't like to hear. Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands. And the Spirit of God spoke to me. He said, you leave that scripture alone. That's your wives. He said, your scripture is this. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loves the church and gave himself for it. Did you know that will interfere with the flowing of the Holy Ghost if you don't love your wife? It's all a part of it. Being a vessel. I'm a vessel. I'm a tool. I've got to be full of God. And so God speaks to my heart and I go, oh, Father, I want to be more full of you. I just want to be more. And I go, and now this time he feels it, don't you? Oh, he felt it. Did you see that water splash? Watch. Water. Man, now he knows. I mean, whoa, what is that? And I've seen it. I've been preaching, and people start weeping. I had one big construction man. He's weeping, and snot's rolling. He says, what's wrong? What's wrong? I said, that's the Spirit of God on you. But it's not enough. And now I can say, wow, I've got a successful ministry. People are crying when I preach. They're being touched. But God says there's so much more. God says there's more. I'm telling you, I'm here to encourage you. I'm saying to Mike Yeager, I am exhorting Mike Yeager, there is more. And I go back, and now I'm in prayer, in the Word, and I take a little bit of time, and I take a little bit of time, and I go, wow. Whoa. All of a sudden, here it is, man. And now he really knows it. He goes, whoa, this is amazing. Oh, God, I'm a sinner. I'm sorry. And he walks away under that conviction for a while. But it's not sufficient to rip the hell out of his heart. Oh, so Pastor Mike, he says, you know what, God? Oh, God. I can't stand my life the way it is anymore. Oh, God, I want to be full of you, God. So when I preach, oh, God, when I preach, he's wet from head to toe. God, get him, God. He falls under the drenching rain of the Spirit. He's weeping, he's wailing, he's crying, and he gets up converted. Want some more, brother? No. I've experienced many miracles, healings, but that isn't good enough. I was out one time ministering, and there was a black African lady, and she was barely moving, just young, about a lady in her late 30s. And I walked up to her, and I touched her elbow, and she said, don't touch me, don't touch me. I said, what's wrong? She said, my ex-boyfriend and his friend last night, I went back to the apartment, and he beat the pulp out of me, and every part of my body is full of bruises. And she couldn't even hardly lift her foot up. She's walking away from me, and Spirit of God rose up in me, and I said, you lying devil. And I pointed my finger at her, and there was another guy with me that can testify this. I said, you foul spirit of infirmity, come out of her now. Honestly, her foot went whoop like a rubber band. Went whoop, whoop, whoop. She turned around as white as a ghost, honestly. She said, her eyes were this big. She said, what did you just do to me? And I preached Jesus to her. I walked into a Lowe's one day. My wife and my kids were with me. And all of a sudden I saw a bunch of commotion. And I saw a young lady who fell down, who was a cashier behind the counter. And she was having an epileptic fit. And I have a PhD and a doctorate of divinity. I only use it for God. And I walked up. I said, excuse me, I'm a doctor, you know. And everybody's moving out of the way. And I leaned over the top of the counter. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. I leaned over. I whispered, in the name of Jesus, you foul spirit, come out. Came right out of it and stood right up. Instantly. It's not me. It's the Spirit of God in me. So, through the years, when I give myself continually to nothing but the prayer and word, not news. See, a lot of people make fun of Smith Wigglesworth. He was just a man. He was a plumber. I like to read. I got a book back there. You ought to read these books. Find out there's more than what you got. Healing is the dinner bell of evangelism. All these years, for 40 years, I always use healing in the gospel message. And I pray for sick. What if they don't get healed right away? I just do what the Bible says. I pray for them, and I believe God. I prayed for a man one time. He had, his liver was shot. Now listen, his liver was shot from alcoholism. I prayed for him. It didn't like nothing happen. Sometime later, one of our guys were downtown witnessing, and he ran into this guy, and this guy said, I know your pastor. He said, what? He said, I was dying. My liver was shot. He said, God gave me a new liver. God gave me a brand new liver. We're Pentecostal preachers. We're Holy Ghost preachers. We've got the Word. Now we just got to be filled with the Spirit. How about you, Pastor Mike? How full of the Spirit are you? Oh, not enough. And even when I get more, it's not going to be enough. I need more. You need more, brother? You need more? I mean, don't we need more of the Spirit? And so this has happened to me approximately, I'm so ashamed, about 5 times since I've been saved. Well, I'll be preaching to a crowd under the power of the Holy Ghost. It happened to me first in Germany. I was preaching to a crowd of people in Germany, and as I'm preaching, I'm declaring Christ. He gave us all. You give your all. He went all the way. You go all the way. He loves you so much. He died for you. What are you doing for him? And as I'm preaching under this amazing flow of the Holy Ghost, like somebody counted, 1, 2, 3, everybody fell out of their chairs weeping and everybody fell down in the meeting, fell weeping, wailing, crying. I had to stop preaching. Nobody was listening to me anymore. I mean, my wife was there. She saw it. And then I was in another meeting, and as I was preaching the power of God, and I'm telling you, I saw it. I'm preaching to this crowd of people, and I saw miniature whirlwinds. You may not agree with this. I saw the whole congregation began to weep and wail and cry. Now, they weren't falling down, and all of a sudden, a whirlwind, I saw them come in, pick people up, and throw them 3, 4, or 5 chairs over. People say, that ain't God, it was God. Oh, I was so under the Holy Ghost influence. I was so drunk in the Spirit. I was so lost in God. I had to get out of there. So I preached what I was supposed to preach, and I ran out the door, and I went and laid on my face, and they told me, they said, when you left, people began to stand up weeping and crying and confessing their sins. That's happened to me about 5 times. I was, just 2 more times and we'll close. I ran way over my time, but see, it's the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, I'm excited, brother. I want to see this happen in the college campuses. I want to see this out on the streets. I want to see you, Brother Jesse. I want to see a video of you out there preaching among the homosexuals, and all of a sudden the fear of God comes in like a mighty wind, and they're all mowed down like grass in a fresh cut field, weeping and wailing and crying. Can I have that, Pastor Mike? Yeah, John Wesley had it. He would tell people, I don't know why, but when I get to preaching, you're going to fall, so don't climb the trees. They climbed the trees to see him, and sure enough, boom, they all fall down, weeping, wailing, and crying. Some of them had visions of hell. Some had visions of heaven. That happened to Mary Woodworth Eddy. Just read it. Just read it. Smith Wigglesworth was so full of the Word and the Spirit, that's all he would do. That he would, and in that book you'll read testimony, he would go, because in Great Britain they travel everywhere by rail train, and he would get on a train, walk into the train, and one time 2 priests fell on their face weeping and wailing and crying, and they said, my God, you convict me of my sin. He said, before you know it, he said, the whole car was weeping and wailing. He led them all to Christ, and he said this in his writings. He said, that happened many times. He said, that happened many times. So I'm preaching in this crowd. Had to get downtown and preach at another crowd. I'm preaching, and I'm preaching out of the book Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord holy, high lifted, holy, holy, and the holiness of God. I felt that the holiness of God is tangible. Did you know this? No, there's a tangible essence of the holiness of God. And I sense the holiness of God come running in, and there is children and infants, and I mean, it was about 140, 50 people. And I ran out the door because I had to get down to this other place. And I went down to this other church, and I'm preaching away, and in the church, yes, in the church, but it's meant for in the harvest field too. And all of a sudden, everybody fell out of their chairs once again, weeping and wailing and crying. Well, this pastor called me up about 3 hours later, after I got out of that service, so it was probably 5 or 6 hours, and he's very quiet over the phone, and he says to me, "Brother Mike," I said, "Yeah." "Does this always happen when you preach?" I said, "Well, brother, I'm not there. Tell me what happened." He said, "Brother Mike, as you ran out the door," he said, "I melted to the floor like a dead man." He said, "I laid on the floor. I couldn't talk. I could not move for 2.5 hours. He said, "I thought everybody had gone home." He said, "I got up off the floor," and he said, "every man, woman, and child was laid out under the power of God and could not move for over 2.5 hours. What is that, Pastor Mike? It's the power of the Holy Ghost. Why don't you have more of it, Pastor Mike? Because the price is high. It's not high, but it is. It is. It is. Whenever I've moved in that realm, he asked me, he had me come to his house. He was very intimidated by me then. He'd never let me come back and preach for him, by the way. It was too frightening. The presence of God, the real presence of God, is scary. It's frightening. The flesh runs from it. And I went to his house, and he had a TV playing, and I didn't pick on him. And he said to me, "Brother Mike, tell me how this happens with you." I says, "Well, I'm not there all the time." I said, but his name was Bill. I said, "I'll tell you what I do, Bill." I said, "All I do is I meditate, sing, speak, and think the word and pray, and I walk the floor for days on end. I just walk the floor. I just walk and pray and walk and pray and walk and pray and walk and pray. And before I know it, the rivers are beginning to flow and the power of God is beginning to be manifested. I begin to get scared. I begin to come into the holiness of God and the purity of God. And the fire is beginning to burn. And then God says, 'Go.' And miracles just start happening. I was preaching. I walked into this little church with an evangelist and his wife. I was 20 years old, just seeking God. Walked into this church, and there was a little lady sitting across from me. She looked over at me, and I knew she was demon-possessed. She see me, she got up, and she ran out of the church. And the Spirit said, Spirit of God said, "Go cast the devils out of her. She's tormented." I said, "Well, Lord, I got to submit to authority." So the service wasn't very long. So it was up in Fairbanks, Alaska. So I went. I never met the pastor. I said, Pastor, I said, "There was a little lady here who ran out the door. Oh, she's not a part of my church. She's messed up. I said, "Okay, can I go see her?" "Oh, yeah." So me and the evangelist and his wife, we got into their little Toyota, went down the road, a dirt road, and we pulled up in front of a place that looked like Sanford and Sons, and this really happened, and there was garbage laying everywhere, old wash machines, dryers, and this old little man comes running out, and he says, "You're men of God, you're men of God." You know, it didn't go to my head. I just said, "You came to help my wife." I said, "Praise the Lord, where's she?" "Well, she's in the kitchen right now, and she's doing something in the kitchen." So I said to the guy, his name was Bob Rhodes. I said, "Come on, Bob." So we went down this goat trail and got there, and it was summertime, so it wasn't cold in Alaska in the summertime. It was in the 80s. I opened up the screen door. Her back's to me. Now listen, liars go to hell. All of these stories you read about that I've experienced in these books, they're not lies. They're truth. And if anything, even more happened than what I shared, but I believe liars go to hell. So I come into this room. I begin to speak about Jesus. Her head swivels on her body. Her eyes are glowing red. She's got a big old butcher knife in her hand where she's been peeling carrots. Fear hits my heart. Whoa! Eyes glowing red. Peeling carrots it looked like a 10-foot knife, but it was probably only about 1.5 feet. Right away, faith rose up in my heart. I said, in my heart, God hasn't given me a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind, you know, and just in my heart. And faith began to rise up, and I began to preach to her. Next thing I know, she spins around supernaturally and comes at me like a rabid animal. She climbs on top of me and begins to hit me. Bam, bam, bam. I say, in the name of Jesus, I'm telling you, I seen it. Bob saw it. The power of God grabbed her. She flew through the air 10 feet, hit the side of their kitchen, crumpled to the floor, and she did not get hurt. And I cast the devils out of her. I was 20 years old. You know, I'm 60 now. And I found out as a little girl she was being molested by her uncle. Her uncle died and kept coming back and raping her, but it was a demon. It wasn't her uncle. So I cast the devils out of her. Praise the Lord. She gave her heart to Christ. She got filled with the Holy Ghost. We began to take her to church. And I'm sharing this story some years later. And as I'm sharing this story, Bob comes to me and he says, Brother Mike. I said, what? He said, you're not telling that story right. I said, what? Am I exaggerating? She said, Brother Mike, I'm telling you, I was standing behind you. She did not drop that knife. I said, what? He said, she was stabbing you in the face with the knife. And I thought you were a dead man. I couldn't believe it. It couldn't penetrate your skin. I'm telling you, I have story after story like that. But it's something that I discovered as a baby Christian. Oh, I need the Holy Ghost. Oh, I need to be surrendered. I need to be submitted. I need to be yielded, or I'm not going to have good results. I want the Holy Ghost to come upon them and deliver them and set them free. Can you say amen? Can you give the Lord a hand clap and a shout? Come on. Listen. I'm not bragging about Mike Yeager. I'm telling you, that is available for you. And it doesn't mean you have to memorize. Now, I'd be honest with you, the Spirit of God came on me and convicted me for not knowing the Word. And you can go on the internet and see me, and I've memorized 10 books of the New Testament. I can quote them to you by heart, James all the way through, and Ephesians and Philippians and hundreds of scriptures. But it's not the amount of scriptures that you got here. A lot of that's here. It's how much you got here and how much you're living. And I just want you to know, I'm not talking about you getting saved. I'm talking about us getting filled. If there is ever time we need to be full of the Holy Ghost, it's right now. You're not here by accident. I'm not here by accident. God knew before the foundation of the world there is going to be a mighty, Jesse, there's a mighty shift coming. That's what you've been hungering for, Jesse. That's what you've been wanting. You've been wanting to see God show up. You're preaching your heart out. You're out there, man, fighting the devil tooth and nail with everything you got. And you've had results, but God is saying, I can bring my spirit of fear upon those people to where they begin to fall like dead men and begin to weep and wail and repent. Those college campuses, those young people, they need to experience God. No, they need to feel the very presence of God. Jesus said this, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. They need to see the manifest. They need to hear the Word and they need to see the Word. And when that happens, watch out, devil. You know, there's a set of foxes that had their tails tied together, and He lit their tails on fire and sent them into the harvest field. That's what God is going to do. He sent them out two by two. I believe we're going to see a mighty harvest. Here's the key, guys. Ladies, we got to pay the price. I ain't going to make you pay the price. You can't make me. You can harp on me. You ain't going to make me. I've got to be desperate for. Yeah. See, listen, I'm not trying to get something from God. I've already got the Holy Ghost. All I'm doing is saturating myself in word and prayer. What do you pray, Pastor Mike? The word of God. Saturating myself in his presence. And as I get saturated, all of a sudden I'm sloppy wet in the spirit, and all of a sudden I lay my hands on people, I speak to people. Oh, you're all wet, brother. And all of a sudden it gets all over them. How many of you want that? How many know you can have it? Tell somebody, I can have it, and I'm going to get it. Now you say, well, I got the Spirit. Oh, wait, I got the Spirit. But he said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. One more story. We're not still recording, are we, Michael? We are. My son Daniel came to me, and he really, really wanted to go on with God. And he came to me, and this was back in 2011, and I said, Danny said, Dad, what do I need to do? I said, Dan, listen to me. Well, listen to me. Give yourself to nothing but the Word of God and prayer. I said, I'm not talking about memorizing thousands of scriptures. You know, not Jack V, whatever his name is. I'm saying just get that Word as you muse on it. If you don't know how to meditate, get my book about how faith comes 28 ways. I talk about how the Word becomes alive in you. I said, just do that, Danny. And he said, okay, Dad, I'm going to do it. And I watched him. He began to spend all day long in the Word, in prayer, in the Word, in prayer, and do his other responsibilities. And I'm watching him change before me and change before me and change before me. And all of a sudden, the world has no attraction to him no more. He's not wasting his time on anything. He's just going after God, going after God. So I had to go to Suriname to preach down there among the Hindus. And so I took Danny with me. So we get down there, and Danny's not really, he preached some up to that time, but not a lot, and he goes one way and I go another way. And so one day we're invited to go speak at a prison where they had the worst criminals locked up in that little nation, and they were rapists and murderers from 12 years old to 18 years old. These were rapers and murderers locked up. And there was a woman who was going in there and trying to evangelize. She could not get nowhere with them. So they want Danny to preach because he's a young man. And so we go in there, and Danny stands up, and he's trying to preach, and he's trying to teach, and nothing's happening, and I can see he's getting frustrated. So I took over. I began to speak. And as I'm speaking, I look over at Daniel, and I see the Spirit of God all over him. You can see the Spirit of God on a person. Did you know that? You can feel it. I saw the Spirit of God on him. I said, Daniel, take over. I wish we had an audio video recorder. Out of his mouth came the most profound message I ever heard about Joseph being in prison. Perfect message. How he was locked up and how God exalted him above the nation. And I mean, that had got them excited. And he's talking, he's preaching away. And I see the Spirit of God hit these young men. They begin to weep and cry. And they all repented. Every one of them. They repented. Every one of them, murderers and rapists and killers, repented. And before you know it, was a sloppy mess. We're all crying. We're all hugging one another. Oh, we're crying. It was heaven on earth. I'd never seen nothing like it in my life. We're all weeping and crying. And then something came to me. And after they got right with God, I said, cry this out. And then they speak another language and cry out, say, I am a Joseph. And they couldn't say Joseph. They could say Yosef. Now, they were in the middle of a men's prison separated from the men, but these about 40 young men began to cry out, I am a Yosef, I am a Yosef, I am a Yosef. And the whole prison is shaking as these young men weeping, crying, smiles on their face. I am a Yosef, I am a Yosef, I am a Yosef. Oh, it was heaven on earth. We can have that on the campuses. We can have that on highways and byways. But you're going to have to die. We're going to have to be like Smith Wigglesworth, who gave himself to nothing but the Word of God in prayer. I'll be honest with you. I have lots of books. I set them all aside. Not that I can't learn from people. I set them all aside. Now, some people, they need that to get them motivated, but give yourself to the Word of God in prayer. Thank you for letting me speak to you. I'm so privileged to speak to you. And all I want you to know is there's more. There's more. Now, Father, I thank you that your word would not return void, but it will accomplish that which it's been sent, and it will prosper in the thing whereunto you have created it. Lord, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I can't wait. I can't wait to get so sloppy, full, so full.